I was first married to my late husband, Rick Bennett. I grew up in the Midwest on a farm and spent my first 20 years in a very rural setting, and that's small town farm area, and that's where my values were formed. Honesty, hard work, community, family. I go back a lot. My mom still lives on the farm. She's 85. She's amazing. I hope I have her genes. Mm-hmm. She's still going strong. I moved here with my husband. We were a young married couple. We moved to Fairfax County. We bought a house and had three little boys and started a real estate business together, my husband and I. He had graduated from law school at Georgetown, wanted to work on his own, and went into real estate. So that's what we did. And we worked together, we raised our kids, and that was going along fine until 22 years ago he got leukemia and he died, leaving me a single working mom with three little boys and a real estate business right in the middle of a really deep commercial real estate recession. So the first few years, as you can imagine, were pretty tough, not only dealing with all of a sudden raising these boys by myself, but trying to save the business, get it back on its feet. We did. I had a lot of help. I had family, friends, teachers, lots of people came around me. I had a great community around me and was able to save the business. The boys they survived the tragedy of the loss of their dad. So fast forward, here I am 22 years later, the business is successful. I've had the business in ups and downs. I've never missed a payroll, took care of my employees. They all stayed with me. I was very fortunate. They could have left when my husband died, but they didn't. And my boys are now in their 30s. They are all married. I have a grandson named Sam. He's 2, he's amazing. And my kids are all starting businesses of their own. So I'm in a pretty good situation. My kids are gonna be fine, but too many families aren't gonna be fine. And our Congress doesn't work. It can't seem to pass bills. I'm seeing this continual eroding of our government and its inability to work and do good things for families. So when this opportunity came up, I said, yes, I will do this. I feel like I've had a great life and I owe it to give back. And it's probably the only thing left I can do for my kids is try and get our government straightened out again so we can turn over a country to them that is the same country that I grew up in, you grew up in. And it really is all about the next generation. It's not about us so much anymore. It's about our kids and giving them opportunities, making sure that the values that our country was founded on remain the values that it lives by. So here I am. I'm running for Congress. So what do I want to do? I'd like to see a rebalancing in the economy. We're in a major transition economically. Globalization and technology are changing our economy very, very quickly. And this change has caused an imbalance. There are a few people doing really, really well, and then there are a lot of people that are struggling and not doing quite so well. We can do something about this. I think the key is education. I think all of our kids need a top-notch education, every child, because that's opportunity. We can't make life equal for people, but we can make it fairer, so that every child has a quality education. We need skills training. With this transition to technology, we have lots of jobs available that we don't have workers with the skills to perform those jobs, but we can do that. I think Governor McAuliffe has recently used the figure 37,000 technology jobs that we don't have the workers available to fill. So we need to use our community college system. We need to teach skills training in high school So that these are good paying jobs. They are $60,000 to $80,000 a year. You can support a family on that. So we need to do that. We need college affordability. Somehow college has gotten to be so ridiculously expensive. I went to public university and public school. I graduated, I didn't graduate with debt. Between a little help from my parents, working part-time jobs, I was able to pay my way through college and come out so that my husband and I could buy a home as a young family. Too many kids now get out with so much debt that they're just frozen out of participation in the economy. That's not good for any of us. So we need to do all of those things. Transportation is a huge issue in Northern Virginia. I am a very strong advocate of an infrastructure bill, a major infrastructure funding source from the federal government, so that we can fix our roads, we can repair our metro system. I'm very concerned. I mean, I'm excited about our metro stops in Loudoun County, but I'm concerned that we're gonna connect to a system that isn't healthy or dependable. And that would be a real tragedy because it would be such a lost opportunity. So we need to fund infrastructure, roads, bridges, water systems. Obviously, what's happened in Flint, Michigan will happen in other places. And we have to have the money available to finance those things. What else? I am for comprehensive immigration reform, similar to the bill that the Senate passed 3 years ago. I think it was a good bill. It touched on a lot of the problems around our broken immigration system. It did require that the borders, you know, we secure our borders first. But then it also dealt with the 11 million undocumented workers that we have here in a way that won't cripple our economy, won't do mass deportations, won't break up families, and will give, you know, deal with it humanely and get them engaged in our economy so they can be productive citizens, you know, hopefully on the path to citizenship. So I'm for that. Let's see, the environment. I believe in climate change. My opponent does not. I think the United States should be leading in this effort. We have a great opportunity to build a green economy. We should be manufacturing wind turbines. We should be manufacturing solar panels here in the United States, not buying them from China and India. We should be doing that here. But we have to acknowledge that climate change is an issue. So I am very much for taking this and finding the opportunity in it. Coming out of the business sector, I have a little bit different lens on the world. When you have challenges, in my experience, there are always opportunities. So you have to find the opportunities and the challenges and go for the opportunities to solve those challenges. And I've done that in my life many times. And I believe we can do it in our country too. I also believe and know that we need to work together. We need to reach across the aisle. We have to start, you know, working with Republicans, working together to pass this legislation. I've never solved a problem that I didn't have to talk to somebody I didn't agree with. You don't solve problems by talking to your friends. You solve problems by talking to the people who don't agree with you. So I'm very much for that. And I know we can do this. We just need leaders in Congress who want to do it. There are many, many more issues. And if you have any questions, I'd like to now open it up to you all and ask you what you're interested in or whether you disagree with something I've said. We can talk about it.
Let me ask you
Does
something.
Anybody have any thoughts?
Yeah, I've got a thought.
Yes.
What do you think about the mudslinging that's going on?
I think it's awful, and I think it's going to create a huge challenge for the next administration. I think the rhetoric that we've had in this election has been the most divisive and hateful that I've ever known, and I'm 63. I mean, in all my years, I've never seen anything like it. And it has deepened a divide that's been building over time. I mean, I think for 20 years we've had this sense of cynicism, and growing cynicism in government. There are people who feel left behind, and that's legitimate. There are people who have been left behind. So there is some truth to that, and both parties have missed it. And we're going to have a window after this election. My hope is that we'll have a window to start that healing and start to pass some legislation that will help people understand that if their government works for them too, and it doesn't just work for the top.
How do we take care of, once the election happens, then whoever wins or loses, I don't care, how do we deal with the division that this country may be facing? I've never seen anything, and I've been involved for a lot of years in this, in the county and in the state of Virginia, so I've never seen a division so bad that I don't know how we recover from it. And I guess I'm asking you, do you have any thoughts?
Well, I can tell you what I'm going to do. Well, I mean, and this isn't going to solve the whole problem, but this is my little piece of it. I'm going to sit down, or attempt to sit down, with every single person in the Republican caucus and spend 15 minutes just face-to-face talking to them and figuring out where we have common ground and starting to develop a face-to-face relationship. I think it's very easy to demonize people you've never met, that you don't see as human beings. And so I want to meet and talk to every single person in the Republican caucus. I'll have time with the Democrats. I want to focus more across the aisle. I also want to go out to the western part of the district, where there are a lot of people who won't vote for me. And I want to talk to them. And I think listening is the key. We need to hear one another. Not just listen, but hear one another. Most people in my experience, and this has been a great gift doing this in this campaign, it gives me hope because most people are good people. I mean, they really are. We're all really more the same than we're different. We all want the same things. We want to take care of our families. We want our children to do well. You know, we're not that different. But we have to hear one another. And there are legitimate complaints on both sides. So we have to start listening and hearing one another. And that's what I would like to do. And, you know, if that means that the first couple of meetings are venting and they can just yell at me, well, so be it. I'm willing to do that until we get to a point where we can start hearing one another. So that's what I'm going to do. I don't know if it'll work, but I don't know what other choice we have.
Well, I'm open
to suggestions.
Well, given the somewhat gerrymandered configuration of the 10th district, go too much into that, but it is a very awkwardly formed congressional district.
Mm-hmm.
That has everything from very urbanized, long-established suburban areas to, as you mentioned, the western counties.
Yeah.
Interact with that are very, very rural, much less industrialized. Have you had much outreach to them so far to kind of hear what
spend
the
a lot of time in Winchester and Clark County? Yeah. I mean, I know that, you know, that's not where most of my votes will come from, but I've spent time there. And I tell you, the diversity of this district is really what I love. I grew up in a rural area. Like I said, I grew up on a farm. So when I go out to Percival and Berryville and Winchester, that feels like home to me in a way that even I didn't anticipate. I love being out there. I love rural areas. They're very grounding. It's where I grew up. It's a big part of who I am still. I raised my family in the eastern part of the district, in Fairfax County. So that's definitely familiar to me. That's where we made our friends. I raised my family. So I have life experience in both sides of the districts, and I see the value of both ways of life. So I feel like I can relate to people who are different than me. My mom is very conservative. My mom and dad are Republicans. They're from Illinois. We used to have great debates at the dinner table, Dad and I. Oh, they were, you know, some of them were humdingers. But each other, and they really, you know, they're wonderful people, and they, I owe them so much. So I think we can, you know, I believe we can do this. I really do. And I'm certainly going to spend my time trying to heal what divide exists here. But I do think it's going to be a tremendous challenge for the country. We are truly stronger together. If we will rise or fall as a nation together. So what choice do we have? We got to keep trying.
I think a lot of things in your opening remarks were philosophies that most people in the room anyway would agree with. Yes, we need to have greater investments in education and infrastructure and a variety of other things. That all boils down to one simple word. It's called money. You know, I remember a saying I believe attributed to a relatively well-known conservative Republican, Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes, whose quote was, if I remember correctly, was that taxes are the price we pay for civilization.
Yep.
So how would you see working with your counterparts in the House, since all tax bills have to originate in the House, to come up with the revenue sources to fund any of the investments that I think most of us would view as necessary and appropriate?
Great question. What we can't do is keep doing what we're doing. And the last 6 years, we haven't passed a budget in the House of Representatives. We haven't passed an appropriations, series of appropriations bills. That's outrageous. Coming out of the business community, I can tell you, if I did that in my business, I wouldn't be in business very long. We continue to give tax cuts to the wealthy. So we continue to cut revenues, and then we let our budgets stay the same. I mean, because we keep passing CRs, continuing resolutions, which means the expenditures stay the same, but we keep reducing revenues. So we can't keep doing that. That I can tell you, because all that will do is add to our deficits and increase our national debt. And that's a problem. That's one of the big issues we need to address at some point. Our national debt is getting way too high. It's one of those things that we're going to be passing along to our kids, and that's not right. So, you know, I believe in targeted taxes that address the issues. I think we need to tell the truth, frankly, to the American people. It's like, we can give you a tax cut, but that means we won't be able to fund education. So let's talk about it. What is our priority? We can't have both. I don't think our politicians, and particularly our leadership now, have been very honest with the American people. There are consequences to some of these policies, and I think we owe it to our constituents to talk about those consequences and really have a conversation about it. So I would be for, we need a fairer, simpler tax code. Everyone needs to pay their fair share. It's not right that major American corporations can get by with paying no taxes to this country. They are so lucky. We are all so lucky to be here, to have been born in this country with so much opportunity. And we do owe back to our country something. And so I believe in shared sacrifice. I don't think any one group should shoulder all of the burden. I think everyone needs to do a little bit, and then it's not terribly painful for any one group. And I also think that we need to reintroduce the sense of national community. This idea that we are all in it together, because it is true. You know, my parents' generation were the greatest generation. I think our generation has not been so great. I think we've been a bit selfish. And we need to understand that this isn't about me, it's it's about us, and we need to start thinking about us again. And, you know, to the extent that I can impact that, you know, I intend to talk about it and try. Yes, sir.
Your twice predecessor, Frank Wolf, had a town hall meeting years ago that I participated in as a phone call conversation. And one of the things that he had tried to do was to work to come up with a proposed location for a cross Potomac Bridge north of Beltway. And he started on it and then declared that it couldn't be done. Why couldn't it be done? Because neither Fairfax or Loudoun wanted it done. They pointed to each other. And I told the congressman at the time that I thought he was the big man in the room and that he should have gotten together with the experts and come up with the proposed two or three alternatives that made sense without regard to whether to adhere to there, because each of them was being parochial. We don't want it in our backyard. But if that was the case, nothing would ever have been built in the United States.
That's
right. So I implore you that if you do get elected, work with VDOT and your counterparts across the river. There is a dire need for bridges both north and south of the current Beltway. The southern bridge is down at the Nice, Governor Nice Bridge, 301 near Dahlgreen. That's 70 miles or 80 miles. The further north bridge is the one at Point of Rocks, which is hard. If you're in Rockville, you need to commute to Virginia, and they'd say that the Beltway is clogged, you're just in your office for 2 hours. You don't try coming home, because you know that you can't do that. Or you go up to Jubal Early Ferry, or you go up to Point of Rocks, and that takes you 2 hours anyway, so you might as well sit in your office. The population of Northern Virginia, the metropolitan DC population, has twice or tripled since the last of these bridges has been built. You go to any other major location, Minneapolis, even Richmond, there is more infrastructure connecting the East and the West than there is in the Washington metropolitan area. And people commute from Maryland to the district, from Virginia to the district or to Maryland, vice versa, and we are stymied by those points. Now, grant you, we need WMATA's forward plan for 2040, which includes additional train lines.
Right.
But it is impossible for somebody who lives in Loudoun, who just works 10 miles away on the other side in Montgomery, to take the train from Loudoun to Metro Center, to get on the Red Line and go up. And maybe they'll have a place at Farragut West and Farragut North. But even so, that's an hour in and hour out. We need a process for people to go circumnavigation. We do not have it. And I think that is a shame that we are stuck with our star system, the lines going into downtown, and no means of moving people around the circumference.
Right.
And the circumference that used to be the Beltway in 1960s, is now not the circumference anymore. Loudoun may have a football stadium, who knows? But the people, nobody's gonna come from Maryland to the Loudoun football stadium if they have to go all the way in and out again.
Right, no, good point.
That's just a view from mine.
No, you're making a very good point. There are a couple of things I would say about that. I think transportation is one of those issues that has to be solved regionally. So we need to start working more cooperatively regionally. In that regard, I've done business regionally for 30 years. I do have long-standing relationships with leaders in the district, leaders in Maryland, and we need to work with them to solve transportation issues.
I serve on a committee of the Transportation Planning Board, the Citizens Advisory Committee. But the Transportation Planning Board of the Council of Governments is not a Transportation Planning Board. It is a Transportation Review Board that reviews what VDOT, MDOT, and DCDOT provided. And they just say, but they never coordinate them and say,
what would be good for the region. Each separate entity submits its plans, and that's why the purple line, the circumference metro line, will never be built, because it benefits not one of them, it benefits all of them. And none of them want to spend the money to do
that. Well, that's partly true, and you and I can debate that topic for quite a while. I don't think we want to interrupt the discussion here, but you do have the Metropolitan Washington Council of Governments,
mm-hmm.
which is jointly and collectively funded at all levels of government. They get a good chunk of money every year from the federal government, both highway and transit.
Mm-hmm.
They get a good chunk of money from the three states. They get a good piece of money from the local member jurisdictions.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they have over the years developed a number of relatively comprehensive long-range transportation plans. In fact, every time they do an update, they do two plans.
Mm-hmm.
Here's what we really need.
Yeah.
Here's what we can afford,
mm-hmm.
given available funding.
Mm-hmm.
There's a major difference between the two. It's also a situation where what's now the Capital Beltway was
right.
originally going to be Beltway number one of three beltways. The Fairfax County Parkway and the Intercounty Connector of Maryland
right. mm-hmm.
are basically what was the general alignment for Beltway number two. Something further out would have been Beltway number three.
Right.
For various and sundry reasons, on both sides of the river, people said, oh no, we can't do that. One of the arguments that my wife and I heard early after we moved to Northern Virginia in the mid-70s was, oh, Metro will solve our problems. We don't need these major highway investments. They didn't even listen to people at Metro who were saying, well, we can't solve all the problems.
No.
So I think there's been that disconnect on the technical side as well.
Sure.
But it's also been on the political elected government side as well.
Right.
About, okay, if so-and-so doesn't want it, that's okay. We'll keep everybody happy. Again, kind of the point you were making, well, we're all in this together.
Yep.
It has to be a group effort.
We're only gonna
Not everybody's going to agree, but you get a consensus, move to the consensus.
Well, everything comes down to money as well, and that's why I'm such a strong proponent of a major infrastructure spend or funding source. Senator Warner has a bill in the Senate called the Bridge Act, and it would take federal money, a core of federal money, and it would leverage that with private money and to lend out for infrastructure spending across the country. John Delaney in Maryland has a bill. It's a two-phase bill. It combines repatriating profits that are being held abroad by our corporations, about $2.4 trillion being held abroad, allowing them to bring that back without paying the additional corporate tax of 15% on top of what they've paid abroad. If they will allow it to be lent out and locked up for a period of, you know, long term, and low interest rate for infrastructure spending, I think that that's an interesting proposal. That doesn't, you know, require additional tax money for that first phase. It's just bringing this money back that we're not going to get back anyway, any other way. So I think we need to pull both of those bills out, see if, you know, they both have bipartisan support. But we're just not getting it done. So we need to start getting some of these things done. We need to get them on the floor of the House. We need to get votes on them. I mean, this idea of blocking legislation in committee, that's what the leadership in the House is doing now, is they won't let things come out to the floor for a vote. We need to let there be floor votes on these. If they fail, they fail. But we need at least to start having votes on major bills that solve problems. We've just got to start solving some of these problems. They can be solved. We just need people with the will to solve them and people willing to take courageous votes and be able to come back and explain, you know, explain to their constituents why this is so important. So,
one of the things you want to understand is that Lewis is a transportation engineer. And Jeff is actually chairman of the land use,
the Fairfax County Transportation Advisory Commission.
So they have an idea,
yeah,
transportation-wise, on
not just what they're doing.
But, you know, a lot of transportation things are happening. The governor's freed up money.
Yes.
66, Transform 66, looks right. like it's on the way. It's, I think the governor said he should sign the contract sometime the 1st December,
right.
Which could help. People want to complain that they're going to have to pay tolls. Well, and that's basically is a tax,
mm-hmm.
okay? But if you want to get the stuff done, this is the only way you're going to do it, unless you're going to take it out of your
pocket. But people don't have to pay tolls. They can go in the three lanes that are not tolled. I mean, they're not, all the lanes aren't going to be toll lanes, mm-hmm. and anyone who chooses to pay the toll will come off the regular lanes. So it should alleviate traffic for everyone.
Yeah, and they'll help pay for the road.
And help pay for the road. Because we do, and long term, we need dedicated funding source to maintain our infrastructure. I mean, we just have to do it. There's no other way. I mean, this idea that some try to sell the American people that there's a free lunch, that nothing, you know, it doesn't have to cost you anything. You can have all these things, but it's not going to cost anything. I mean, it's just not true. It's fantasy. And we have to be more honest with people than that.
My wife asked me to ask.
Sure.
What is your view on rights, female rights?
Oh my goodness.
I know I'm opening this up.
No. I am pro-choice. I believe women should make their own healthcare decisions. I also am for equal pay for equal work. As you probably know, my opponent has voted against that bill twice in the House. So we're in very different places on women's issues.
As far as women's rights,
mm-hmm.
the equal pay, yes, my wife gets ticked off on that because she worked for the federal government for probably about 30 years. And she saw where, because she raised a family coming in and out of government, she ended up being behind everybody else. And she didn't feel it was fair to women because they were working, doing the same job as men, I guess, is what the bottom line was.
Yeah, I'm not sure what the rationale for paying two people different wages for doing the very same work.
Do you have any idea why Barbara Comstock is thinking this? I mean, your campaign literature is saying that what she believes in, women should basically, if what I'm reading it, shouldn't have rights. A bunch of men should decide whose rights they've got.
I can't speak
okay.
for the Congresswoman. I just know what I
what you
believe and will fight for. I also believe that we need common sense gun safety measures. We need universal background checks. We need to close the gun show loophole. I grew up on a farm. I learned to shoot a .22 rifle when I was about 8 years old. My dad was a hunter. I have no interest in repealing the Second Amendment. Most gun owners are responsible gun owners, but we need to ensure that people who are either emotionally unstable or intend to do someone harm don't get their hands on guns. We also need to find a way to keep guns out of the hands of people on the terror watch list. To me, that's just common sense, and it's a homeland security issue. We need to keep our neighborhoods and our communities safe and our kids safe. So, you know, that's what I will vote for and I will support.
Are all those points being made in your campaign literature and your
yep.
commercials?
Mm-hmm.
Some of them I have not heard before. Maybe it's just
yeah.
the time of day I'm looking at the commercials.
But I don't think any commercial now I've heard in the last.
It's all on on the website, I'm
okay.
sure.
Yeah.
Because the commercials
yeah.
are, your opponent is doing this.
True.
And that nothing, I haven't heard one that says, I believe in X. It's my opponent.
Well, the equal
Y.
pay one says, I believe in equal pay, yeah. You know, this has been quite an interesting revelation to me with the polling and the targeting. And works and what moves people, and so you can't talk. There are a lot of things I could talk about, but we need to be a little bit targeted in our message.
What is your goal? What's your sense now that it's 2.5 weeks out?
Yeah.
3 weeks out from the election. Do you have a feel for where the polls are going?
Yeah. We took a poll last week, an internal tracking poll, that shows that we are winning by 4%. Now, this is the first time that a Democrat has been in the lead in the 10th district in 36 years. It's not over. We have 3 weeks to go. There is a lot of money on her side of things, and she, I'm sure, will do whatever she can to hold on to her seat. So it will be ugly. It's going to be hard-hitting. We also have, you know, help from our friends, and so, you know, hopefully we can hold on to our lead and
win the
seat.
Do you think the coattails are helping?
Pardon me?
The coattails?
Yeah. Top of the ticket will be very helpful in this race. I mean, the 10th district is a prototype of the kind of district that Donald Trump at the top of the Republican ticket will have an impact on. It's a highly educated district. It's a relatively affluent district. It's a suburban, you know, district, and those are all things that, you know, tend to not, and Donald Trump doesn't appeal to that, our demographic. So it's, the polling is pretty, yeah, there should be coattails. So.
That's good for us.
Good year for Democrats.
I have a question that's just out of curiosity. Do you find a lot of people go to your website? Because I've been meaning to do it, but haven't.
You know, probably not as much, yeah, because I do get a lot of questions about things that I know are on the website, you know, and I'm as guilty, you know, I tend to do a lot of things I don't do either, so, but do go onto the website.
Well, I've been meaning to, so yeah, I know, yeah. But it's nice to get a chance to hear from you tonight.
Good, well, I'm, you know, I'm happy to talk about all of these things.
Well, the thing is that I think until we have the debates, Hillary Clinton has been hitting the websites, basically saying, look at my website, look at my website, look at my website.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, she does talk about it all the time. Go to HillaryClinton.com.
Yeah.
She hears that a lot.
So yes. We're getting around into doing things on the websites type of stuff. We were talking before you got here that the Manila, the group of people that we're not, I'm over, so I'm not dealing with them. I deal with, you know, I'm lucky to use, take the keyboard out and use it type of thing. I use the emails type of thing, and messages type of thing. I'm getting around to it. My children run circles around me, okay? My daughter and both son both went to state schools in Virginia. My daughter is actually at Virginia Tech working on her doctorate degree.
Cool. Yeah.
And loves it down there. And my son went to VCU in Richmond.
Yep.
Now lives in Richmond because he loves Richmond.
My oldest son's moving to Richmond.
Okay.
Or just moved to Richmond. Yeah, it's a great.
Oh, it's a great city. I never zeroed in on it until he went there. I just looked. It was the capital.
Right.
Not anything beyond that. But,
that's right.
He loves
what
it.
What does
down.
He do?
He works for Atrio, which is the owner of Philip Morris.
Yep. I know the company. They're headquartered there, right?
Yeah. Well, they're in Boston. Makes a trip twice a year up to Boston.
Right.
But yeah, he got the job there right out of college, which I tickled pink. He's not at home. There's my daughter. Both of them have got jobs outside of home. But the state of Virginia basically did this. And we had to take out loans on both of them. Not big ones, fortunately. And mommy and daddy, we agreed to pay for them. So they're not being tackled. It's tough on many kids.
Today, it's a real advantage if you have help with your college that you don't have to take out loans.
So, what do you think of Bernie's suggestion?
Pardon me?
Bernie's suggestion about free college.
College affordability? Well, I think there are some things that we can do right away for the kids that do have student debt. And one is lower the interest rate. The federal government shouldn't be making profits on kids who have student loans. So, you know, the interest rate. rates are low across the board. We shouldn't be charging high interest rates. We can extend the payback periods, and that will reduce the payment. We can also index payments to your salaries. When you first get out, you don't make as much, you pay less back, but as your income grows, then you can pay more back. These are all things that are being done by other countries, and they work, and they're not hard, and those are things we can do right away to, you know, relieve the pressure on debt.
When I grew up living in the city of New York, there was a city university in New York that basically said if you graduated from high school in the city of New York, you can get into any one of the city university colleges. But many kids got in, and within a year or two, they were out because the fact that it was free and anybody could qualify, many people went in. And it wasn't what they were meant to be. They were taking that sometimes because they didn't want to be drafted. This is free, why not do it? And what I'm trying to say is that if it's too cheap, you encourage people to go the wrong way, to waste time,
right,
when it may not be what they're made to be. They might be better off with a two-year degree,
right,
or an apprenticeship. But
that's
apprenticeships,
right,
cost money, aren't available. And yet, those are the types of jobs that the country needs as well as educated people.
Exactly. No, I think we need to expand the options, the way kids think about, you know, their options. We have a community college system that would be perfect for, you know, those types of skills training, two-year certificates that lead to good jobs. So we need, those options need to be open. Also, you know, aligning the first 2 years of a college curriculum in the community college system so that a student could go at a lower expense to a community college and then transfer for the last 2 years. That would cut college costs significantly. So there are lots of things we could do. These are fixable problems. We just need leaders who want to fix them, you know, who are willing to do it. So that's what I'd like to do. You know, there's one thing I'd like to address, and, you know, I suppose maybe you could question bringing up. There is an ad that my opponent has run against me that talks about a project that we've done. It's about a preschool that was to be built on a development site that I inherited when my husband died. And I just want to tell you my side of this story, which is basically, it's false. We amended the ground lease. The ground lease originally did call for a preschool to be built, but over time that lease was amended between the city and my partnership 3 times. And one of those amendments allowed us to put an additional $1 million into an educational foundation, which we had also committed to do. So this is a project that I am so proud of because it involved a government, a private developer, and a community that all came together. When we developed the first half of that site several years ago, probably 3 or 4 years ago, we were able to put almost $10 million back into the community to reinvest in the community. A $3 million educational foundation for kids that live around the site, and almost $7 million to 2 community groups for healthcare, education, economic development around that site. And the Community Foundation of the Greater Washington holds about $6.4 million of those dollars. The foundation, which I continue to be involved with, has given away already $650,000 in educational support for this underserved community. It's a high poverty area. So I'm really proud of this, and you know, we will be getting, it's not something I probably would have talked about except that there are false statements being made about it, so it does open the door for me to actually talk about something I'm very proud of accomplishing. So, just so you know.
So it's not a parking lot?
No, it's not a parking lot. No. It's actually, we opened the first Walmart store in the District of Columbia.
Is this
it's
the
a second floor Walmart, huh?
This is the two-story Walmart
on the second floor. We have street retail on the ground floor, second floor Walmart, and then 300 apartments above it. So it's gotten awards. It got the Washington Business Journal Best Community Impact Award because of our amenity package, the propers that I just told you about. So, you know, it was hard. It was hard to keep together over the years. It was hard to get developed. But we did it, and it benefited everybody. And that's what our government needs to do more of. It needs to partner with the business community and other communities and do projects that benefit everyone. It can work. I know it, because we did it.
But your opponent seems to want to paint it totally as a different view.
Well, you know, she has nothing else.
You're right. I'm not disagreeing.
When you can't defend your voting record, and you can't defend the top of the ticket, all you have left is to smear your opponent. And sadly, you know, facts don't matter much when that's all you've got. And, you know, that's sadly the state of affairs in our political system today. And I knew that I was, you know, this, I was taking on something tough when I decided to do this.
Do you have a rebuttal on your website?
Yes, we have my partner, Brig Owens, who's the former Redskin. He was my husband's partner. He continues to be my partner in a lot of the work we do. He has shot a video. It's online, and you can find it on the website, and he talks
from
about it.
From your website?
Pardon me?
From your website, this
yes, website. On my website, yeah. So you can find that information.
For everybody to know.
Yeah.
Because it is
sure. I mean, it is
well.
Troubling. Based on what's said in the ad, it is troubling, but it's just not true.
I mean, we realize that what they put out there mm-hmm. in the ad was for something that happened quite a while ago.
That was 20 years ago.
Date was quite a while ago.
Actually,
and we said, what's there now? Is it still a parking lot, or
no,
somebody else go there? So
it's
be nice to know that.
It's a 340,000 square foot development.
Yes, it would be good for everyone to know that.
And we have met every obligation to the city. We have what's called estoppel certificates, which is a statement signed by the government that we have met every obligation. We have 10 estoppel certificates over the course of the period that we've had the ground lease. Four separate city administrations have signed them. They all state that we are perfectly current on all rent payments, tax payments, and obligations under the lease. So there just is no truth to the allegation. And
And you can't get the mayor to say this?
Well, we did, through our attorneys, write a cease and desist letter to the stations that were airing the ad. Many of them, it's now not playing on many of them. I think one or two of them may still be playing it, but we'll decide later how we handle that. I mean, it is actionable. It gets into election law, but right now I've got a race to win.
That's right.
I have to focus on this election right now, so that's what we're going to do.
Okay. Any other questions? Nothing. I thank you for coming. Sorry we don't have a bigger group.
Well, this has been perfectly delightful. It's been nice to meet all of you. Thank you for coming, and you had great questions, and it's good to
I'm just looking for the word estoppel, isn't it?
Nice to meet you. Thanks so much.
Nice to meet you.
Thanks so much.
Are you broadcasting?
Yeah.
No.
You recording?
Yes.
Can I get a copy of that? Run at your feet?